Hi viewers, I am Dr. Jettinger Losa. As you well aware that I am running a YouTube channel called Law Speeches, in which I am posting my lectures on different subjects of law and also posting the developments happening in and around the world. I request all of you to subscribe to my channel, and if you feel the content is good, please like it and share it among in yourself as well as in your friends community. So this channel is only meant for to spread the legal awareness, to create the law abiding society. And today I am discussing an important topic in the Constitution of India, that is the fundamental rights. So before embarking upon the fundamental rights, as you well aware that Constitution of India is a very, very sacred and document, which is resulted because of a lot of endeavors made by legal luminaries of those era, including Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar, Kripalani, Sardar Patel, Maulana Azad, like that innumerable persons have those Constituent Assembly legal luminaries, they sat and they created this wonderful document called the Constitution of India. I had a lecture which are available in YouTube. You can go through it, where I discussed the historical making of the Constitution of India and the futures of the Constitution of India. And today I am focusing on the fundamental rights. What does it mean by fundamental? So the name itself is signifying fundamental. It is a basic, is called as a fundamental. In other words, we can say it is a inalienable rights which cannot be taken away by the state or any other at any point of time. Those are be called as a fundamental rights. You know the famous English jurist Salmond has remarked that when you speak about the right, you also speak about the duty. Rights and duties are correlative. They go together. Once right becomes other's duty, and other's duty becomes one's right. So there is a interchangeable, vice versa things are there between the fundamental right, these rights. So the fundamental right is no exemption to it. The Part 3 of the Constitution of India guarantees the fundamental rights from Article 12 to Article 35. So we discuss outlines of those articles before embarking up the discussion. You know the fundamental rights, what is the need for having the fundamental rights? So need is that we were under the subjugation of the foreign rulers since years together. The Afghanis, Mughals, Turkish, so different invaders came in the 7th century onwards. Thereafter, after 16th century, the European invaders, they came from Portuguese, Dutch, French, English, so they came in use of trading. And after gaining the entry into India, they had acquired the territories and also the power. You know, any foreign power, they try to exploit the not only the human beings but also the resources. So that has happened if we see the our checkered history of India is concerned. So we suffered a lot during all this period, and the makers of the Constitution of India, they had the experience, they have seen the historical perspectives, and they wanted to give us a rights. Those things should not repeated, so they provided the state has to guarantee certain rights that be called as a fundamental rights. In the international perspectives, if you see, in modern history of the world, says that fundamental rights are a replica of the Magna Carta of England. In 1214, King John, he declared certain rights to the British subjects as a basic rights, and the world knows those things as the Magna Carta. And in addition to that, they had the Bill of Rights have been recognized in United Kingdom, and that has gone to United States of America when it was fighting for independence, war of independence there in 17th century. There it has been declared as the Bill of Rights, the Philadelphia documents of 1689. There certain rights have been recognized. Citizens of that country have certain basic rights that cannot be violated by the state any point of time. And that was perlocuted into France, the Fifth Republic. During its revolution, French Revolution, they have declared Declaration of the Right of Man and the Citizens of 1789. The declaration basically lies upon liberty, equality and fraternity of brotherhood. So it had given these rights to the people of the Fifth Republic, and the time is passing, and in 1885 we had the Congress Party was started in India by A.C. Hume and W.C. Benazee, and they had at the time of its inception, they had desired that Indians should be given a role in the administration. As you well aware that the first war of independence of 1857, Jhansi Lakshmibai, Tantia Tope, they fought heroically for the liberation of the country from the British clutches. But miserably they had failed. But the coming to force of the formation of the Congress party has regenerated the spirit of independence. And as you well aware that the different enactments were made by the British government, basically 1909, 1919 and 1935 Government of India Act. Thereafter they declared the Indian Independence Act of 1947. So during this time the British regime again they forced us to the wars, First World War in 1919, Second World War in 1939. Though the India, the people were not interested, but they were forced to participate in the world wars that resulted into massacre of thousands of Indians. So that should not be there. The abuse of human rights were reported widespread, not only in our freedom movement but also in the world wars. So when we became a liberator from the British clutches, it was the makers, they had in mind that the same should not be happen to the their generations. That is the reason we have inserted the part third as a fundamental rights. So as I told you that from Article 12 to Article 35, these are the articles speaks about the fundamental rights. Then Article 12 provides what is the meaning of the state, what is the means and includes of the state has been added in the Article 12. There is no meaning is provided to it. Then Article 13 speaks about the judicial review of the actions made by the legislature. That is itself is a fundamental right under the Constitution of India. Then Article 14 to Article 18 speaks about the right to equalities. That is Article 14 lays stresses upon the two important doctrines. The right to equality means and includes equality before law and the equal protection of the laws. So it is a duty of the state to protect us equally, whatever our status, whatever our capacity, whatever our caste, religion, place of birth, all are immaterial. It is a duty of the state to provide, treat us equally. The first doctrine of the equality before law, we got it from the British unwritten constitution, whereas the second doctrine, the equality of protection of law, which he got from the American constitution. That means that from prime minister of the country to a ordinary postman or a ordinary citizen, this is a duty of the state to protect them equally and treat them equally. That is there in the Article 14. Then Article 15 also, a general article with regard to equality of the law is concerned, which says state should not discriminate by basic upon the status, sex, place of birth and so forth. So it is liability is castigated upon the state not to discriminate under Article 15. Then Article 16 is a specific article of the Article 15 is concerned, where in matters of the state, equal opportunity should be provided to all the citizens of India, irrespective of caste, creed, religion, place of birth, status, or what may not. But when we speak about the equality, there should be full equality should there in the society. When there is a unequals are there, some segment of society, they are suppressed and oppressed for years together, centuries together, then you cannot speak about the equality. So exemption is also provided to bring them into the mainstream of the society. The downtrodden, oppressed and suppressed should be brought to the mainstream of the society. A positive discrimination can be made of. That is the inner principle of the this our right to equality principles are concerned. That is the reason Article 16 specifically provides special provisions for the women and children and suppressed, oppressed and backward classes. For that we have the reservation system is available. Because all these years they have been suppressed of their rights, because the Varna system resulted all those aspects, then that has to be wiped out slowly. That is the reason the positive discrimination is allowed under the Constitution of India. There is no negative discrimination is allowed, but a positive discrimination is very much allowed as per the principles of the Constitution of India is concerned. Then even the Supreme Court from time to time has provided, yes, positive discrimination can be allowed. Champakam Dorai Rajan case of 1950s to Indra Sahani case of 93-94, and all these years the Supreme Court has upheld that there should be a positive discrimination should be there. Otherwise the oppressed and suppressed people, they cannot be brought to mainstream of the society. In addition to this, Article 17 also speaks about the right to equality principle, that is the abolition of the untouchability. As you know that the Varna system, which was perlocuted into our system since 5000 years, when Manu drafted the famous Manu Charitra, so this system of Varna has come into prominent position in our country. So to avoid certain sections became untouchables, to remove that, we are inserted this Article 17 into as a fundamental right under the right to equality. Then we have the Article 18, which is also a fundamental right, which speaks about the abolition of the titles. When the Britishers were ruling us, they provided a titles to the different people basing upon their choice, like Sir title, Rao Bahadur Sir, Dada Nauruzi Sir. So this is creating the inequality. Certain people have been provided of the Sir and certain people have been provided of no such awards or titles. So when we declared ourselves as equal, so this has been removed by this by Article 18, titles have been abolished by the Constitution of India itself. Then for that, different enactments were enacted by the Government of India from time to time, and even in exemplary services, the Government of India is providing the Bharat Ratna, Padma Vibhushan, Padma Shri awards that cannot be called as a titles. Even Supreme Court also clearly and categorically had stated that these Bharat Ratnas are Padma Shri or Padma Vibhushan cannot be called as a titles in its judgments. So these are the articles which speaks about the right to equality from the Article 14 to Article 18. Then we go to article, another important article, that is Article 19, which provides us regarding the freedoms. So freedom is important to human existence. Without freedoms, we cannot exit. So these freedoms are there from Article 19 to Article 22 of the Constitution of India. So Article 19 not only providing the freedoms, because as already I told you that all our rights are not absolute rights, they are limited rights. Our rights can be curtailed by the state basing upon the security of the country, our nation, basing upon the law and order situation, and basing upon the any other sensitive reasons. Then we have the Article 19 also not an exemption to these kind of restrictions. So Article 19 speaks about the right of freedom of speech and expression. That is a paramount right. Freedom to express your ideas, communicate your ideas, exchange your ideas. Freedom of speech and expression by different modes, by mouth, by press, media, electronic media, social media, not to express, become a silent. That also be called as a fundamental right that has been stated, reaffirmed by the Supreme Court in number of cases. And we'll discuss all those aspects in later lectures. But here I am only outlines I am providing. Then we have the freedom of assembly. So assembly itself is one of the freedom. You can assemble for marriages, you can assemble for any political meetings or social gatherings or civil gatherings. So that right is there. It's a fundamental right. But if any restrictions are there, then you have to, any stipulations are there before assembly, you have to get the permissions. Now we are, world is seeing, India also seeing the COVID. Every nation is observing the COVID protocols. You should not, within your gatheration should be limited to certain people. You cannot say that, no, I have the fundamental right of assembly. I can gather, we can gather. No. You should have to observe from time, as I told you also, that our rights are not a fully absolute rights have been guaranteed to us. We have the limited rights are there as per the situations, you have to exercise your rights. Then we have the right of to freedom to form associations. You can form an association. Association is nothing but is a combination of certain people coming together for certain purpose is called an association. You can form it, you can register it. Under the acts are there, Societies Act is there, and also Trust Act is there. So different enactments are there. As per that, you can register and you can perform, you can discharge the such societies or associations. That is itself is a fundamental right. But in use of this formation of association, you should not indulge into the unsocial and illegal activities. that is prohibited by different enactments. Then we have another fundamental right, that is a right of momentum. You can move from one place to other place through the territory of India without any kind of hindrances. That itself is a fundamental right. You can go to Delhi, you can go to Kanyakumari, you can go to any place, but this is also have certain restrictions. Suppose if you want to go to a tribal areas, very sensitive areas, or areas has been declared as a disturbed areas, then you have to get the permission, prior permission from the authorities, then only you'll be allowed to go. So that is a another aspect we have to remember. You know, if you want to go to a Chhattisgarh, a tribal area, which is a prohibited area, or Assam or northeastern areas where the people momentum is prohibited, are you in Andaman, in Ongo tribes, people are there, then there you have to get the prior permission. Why? Because you are entering into the area where the cultures are differs, where living is differs, you cannot disturb them. So that is the reason. And even in public tranquility also important with this view, this kind of restrictions have been imposed upon our fundamental right of momentum. The next right is the freedom of residence. As a citizen of India, as you can stay, reside anywhere in the territory and breadth of India. There is no bar, but certain areas have been not allowed to be resided, like the tribal areas I told you, and like the disturbed areas where Disturbance Act is enacted, is enforced. In such areas, you are not allowed to reside. Then another important right, freedom, which is provided here, is that freedom of profession, occupation, trade and business. So you can start any sort of business, any sort of, you can hold any sort of occupation, yeah, you can hold a profession, but to become an advocate, to have a profession of advocacy, one should have the bar council enrollment should be there. And you want to start a business, you should have to get a procure the trade license or some other license from the municipality or gram panchayat. So there is a no discrimination, but you have to follow certain restrictions. That is, it itself is a fundamental right under this this part is concerned. Then we have the another right which is provided under the Article 20 of the Constitution of India, that is the protection of in respect of conviction for offences. So where three kinds of doctrines have been provided. The first one is the doctrine of ex posto facto law. That means where a criminal proceedings have been there, as per the when a offense is happened, whatever offense is liable for punishment on the day of happening, that should be allowed to be, that is only to be imposed off. Subsequent amendments were made, then it is not. So that be called as a ex posto facto law. Then we have the the double jeopardy. That is a man should not be convicted for the two times for the same offense. That be called as a doctrine of double jeopardy. And that is a another doctrine is a prohibition of the against self incrimination. So when you are facing substance criminal charges, you should not be a witness. The same man cannot be witness. So that is also, these three important doctrines also became a fundamental right under the Article 20 of the Constitution of India is concerned. Then we have another important fundamental right which is called as protection of life and personal liberties under Article 21. You know that Article 21 is a very, very small article, but we can derive number of things from this Article 21. I read the article. No person shall be deprived of life and liberty except by due process of the law. This is the Article 21. So this article is very, very comprehensive article covering everything of a human being, life and personal liberty. So this article has resulted into coming of into of number of rights. Those include right to environment, right to ecology, right to life, right to shelter, right to food, right to livelihood, right to privacy, right to education. So these are the matters which are covering the life and personal liberties have been included, incorporated. So day by day, this article is expanding in the hands of the Supreme Court of India and also the various high courts. No other article having received such a wide interpretation than that of this Article 21. So even if there is no remedies available, then you can go to the Article 21. You can knock the door of the Article 21, you can get the remedy. So is a Article 21, we can write number of thousands of books upon the Article 21. So it is this article is day by day expanding the origin of the Constitution of India. So this is the most important article in the Constitution of India is concerned. Then there is Article 22, another important article, which provides us safeguards against the arbitrary arrest and detention. So that includes that when a person is arrested by the law enforcement agencies, he should be informed of his grounds of arrest, and arrested person should be produced before the nearest magistrate within 24 hours, excluding the travel time. And he should be given a chance to defend by a competent advocate of his choice. Then, if the law enforcement machinery wanted to extend the detention of him for more than 24 hours, there should be an order from the magistrate. So this is another important article which is provided to us under this part 3rd of the Constitution of India. Then this same Article 22 also speaks about the preventive detention laws in India. That means generally a person is arrested after commission of an offense, but in case of the preventive detention, though the offender has not committed the offense, but he can be arrested basing upon the knowledge by the state that he may going to commit an offense. So that is there, that be called as a preventive detention. Then we have the further, if we go, we have the right against exploitation, which is there under Article 23 and 24 of the Constitution of India, which these articles bans the form of indentured labor as well as the beggar system of labor under Article 23. Then Article 24 also speaks about the right against exploitation. The child labor is prohibited under Article 24. The prostitution is prohibited, immoral traffic is prohibited. For that, we have enacted number of enactments. Even Supreme Court also, from time to time, has making its comments or judgments into these articles. Then we have the another important article, fundamental right, which is available to us under, that is Article 25 to 28, which speaks about the right to religion. You know, this, so the religion is the most affected aspects in human beings are concerned. And India is a land of all the religions, where Hindus, Mohammedans, Christians, Jainism, Sikhism, Zoroastrians. So it is a land of multi-religious nations. And we are coherently observing the religions in our country. But state is a secular state. In matters of state, we follow the secular, that also been there inserted in the article, in the preamble of the Constitution of India by the 42nd Amendment of 1976. The word secular is added. But the people are citizens of India. They can follow the religion which their conscience permits. The three important pieces have been available under this article. That is, right to profess any religion, right to practice, and right to propagate whatever religion they want. So that is an important aspect. But while practicing your religion, you should not disturb the social order. That also been there. Restrictions are there in this articles. So a coherent society, a tolerant society, is a aim of the Constitution of India. Then we have the Articles 29 and 30 of the Constitution of India, which speaks about the cultural and educational rights. So cultural and educational rights, Article 29, and where you can, culture and education is important to us, to maintenance of our identity. And even minorities have been given this right under these articles. So they have the minorities, they can have process culture, they can propagate their culture, they can start an education institutions under the Article 30 of the Constitution of India. But they have to adhere the rules and regulations from time to time, which is being prescribed by the various government agencies or by statutes. Then Article 31, which speaks about certain saving laws that include mostly land laws, have been added under this Article 31. Then another important article, that is the Article 32 of the Constitution of India. So 32 to 35, which speaks about the right to constitutional remedies. So Article 32, I just referred that important. Why? Because Dr. B.R. Ambedkar himself has remarked that the soul of the Constitution lies in the Article 32 of the Constitution of India, where it has providing writ jurisdiction, writs. If your right is violated, you can go to the Supreme Court of India, the apex, which is the apex court of the land in our country, by filing the writ petitions. We have five kinds of writs are there. Writ of habeas corpus, writ of mandamus, writ of certiorari, writ of prohibition, and writ of quo warranto. These are the five important writs which have been provided under this article. You know, not only Supreme Court has been provided of the writ jurisdiction under the Constitution of India, even high courts also been provided under the Article 226 of the Constitution of India. The same kind of writs have been there to the high courts. Even Supreme Court also repeatedly, number of cases, including the one most landmark judgment, the Kumar case, it has remarked that before coming to us, it is better you go to the petitioners, you should go to the high courts. They have the empower to deal the matters with regard to writs. So these writs have been vibrating our democracy, we can say, in other words. The writs are, upon this, the entire structure of the Constitution of India is basing, that is, it is considered as a basic structure of the Constitution of India by, in a case called Keshananda Bharati case versus State of Kerala, which was reported in 1973. So in use of rights, you cannot abuse it. For that we have, because our society is not a fully empowered to go to the courts. And in 1980s, the Supreme Court has innovated a doctrine called public interest litigation, and it has loosened the doctrine of the locus standi. That means only the persons, before to that, only the persons whose rights have been affected, they go to the court of law. But in 1980s, Bandhu Mukti Morcha case and Asian Village case, Games case, so all these cases, the Supreme Court has widened the doctrine of locus standi there. If upon the others, you can go to the court, that be called as a public interest litigation. So that has been added, a new feature is added to the Constitution of India under the fundamental rights. But again, the Supreme Court had stated in Chaudhary case, Janata Dal vs. Chaudhary case, and Samarjit Singh Mann case, you cannot abuse the public interest litigation. If it is a private interest litigation or a personal interest litigation, in use of public interest litigation, you cannot allow to perpetuate this personal litigation. If you does, you are liable for punishment in form of fines and other ways. So these are the aspects which we covered, are be called as a fundamental rights, which are enforceable under the state. The state has to guarantee our fundamental rights at the all the time. So these are the golden rights which are there available in the Constitution of India. And these rights have led to incorporation of the rights in other countries. If you observe the many African constitutions, Kenya, Mozambique, Zimbabwe, or even in Southeast Asia, which has gained the independence after us, after coming to force of the Constitution of India, they also borrowed the golden principles, and they also included into their constitutions. So, the golden principles of Constitution have been inserted by the makers of the Constitution of India under the Part 3rd of the Constitution of India, which are purely enforceable in the hands of the state, and state has to adhere all those rights which have been provided under the Part 3rd of the Constitution of India. But already I told you that rights are not absolute rights in democratic polity. Rights and duties, they go together. So our fundamental rights, though it is a fundamental in nature, but have certain restrictions are there whereupon we can enforce our rights. So this is with regard to my lecture on the fundamental rights. In this lecture I have given the only few outlines, and in succeeding lectures I will provide in-depth and analysis as well as the stand of the Supreme Court of India regarding the each and every right is concerned. And once again I would like to request all of you to subscribe to my channel and assist me in promoting the legal knowledge to the nook and corner of the in our country but also in the entire globe. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you one and all.